that religious institutions should reflect social changes, but should it be changed in forceful ways, Mr. Speaker? We do not think so. First of all, they talked about social changes reflecting religious institutions reflecting social changes, and that religious institutions themselves change in order to aim according to that. Mr. Speaker, we believe that idea itself is very wrong, because you're now saying that religious institutions should always change their ideas in order to apply these social changes. We do not think so, because from the very beginning we have told you how religious itself is secular from our government and so on. Why are you, or who are you, to say that religious ideas should change in terms of social changes, Mr. Speaker? We also believe that this idea itself is very, very crucial and very harmful, because this is not only talking about a page of a Bible, we're talking about a fundamental idea that this religious institution rely on entirely, Mr. Speaker. Now, why are these religious concepts so important for these religious institutions? Because, Mr. Speaker, for simply those people under that religious boundary, their lives are based upon that religious idea. Their brain wirings are based upon those things. Their behaviors and mindsets and judgments, or value of judgment calls, are all based upon such ideas, Mr. Speaker. We believe that the government cannot simply say that these individuals should also be changed with their mindsets just because the government believes that they should apply social changes, Mr. Speaker. Now, moving on to our second pledge. So what kind of message does it send? No, sir. Now, first of all, Mr. Speaker, we have clearly told you that this is a contradicting principle from the very opening government. We have told you that this is a very ironic government, saying, in order to protect the very rights of these individuals, we're going to compromise the religious rights. We believe this is a very contradictory and a dual stance to say, in order to protect some rights, we're going to sacrifice some rights, Mr. Speaker. This is a very contradicting stance and a dual stance, Mr. Speaker. However, furthermore, we have told you that this is going to send out messages that furthermore, the government can step into such social changes and say religious institutions are subject to change furthermore, Mr. Speaker. We believe this opens the ground for further intervention and so on. They also talked about religious capacity. We believe this itself is very wrong from the very first place, Mr. Speaker, because we do not think they are the ones who should judge whether religious institutions have the capacity to change or not. But first of all, Mr. Speaker, first of all, as the closing side actually admitted, there are priests or gay priests being elected, Mr. Speaker. We believe this social changes or religious institutions changing naturally, Mr. Speaker, is okay. However, we do not believe that the government side is the ones to determine whether they have the capacity or not, or to force such ideas to change, Mr. Speaker. We believe they do not have any incentive to accept such social changes when they themselves do not actually apply to those changes, Mr. Speaker. Now, moving on to my last question, who actually better embraces such minorities, Mr. Speaker? Now, are these minorities being oppressed under their model? Mr. Speaker, we do not believe that these people are being oppressed under their model, because we've never heard a single analysis from the government side why these religious rights could be overridden because of the criteria of jobs. They've merely asserted, they've never outweighed why religious rights can be sacrificed, Mr. Speaker, because this is simply they believe that religious sectors can easily be overridden. But furthermore, Mr. Speaker, they contradicted by saying the capacity lacks. But however, they also talked about how the social trend is moving and religious institutions are also changing. We believe this is a very major contradiction from the closing government side. But on the other hand, we, the closing government side, have told you how it only worsens this. We do not believe that the government side guarantees women's rights or gays' rights. We also told you that the opening opposition side told you that it further segmentizes. But the closing government has told you how it further segmentizes, Mr. Speaker. First of all, we told you these people are going to be even more ostracized and segmentized. How? Because we have told you these groups of people who share a fundamental belief do not really want the acceptance of such people, Mr. Speaker. Well, it may be changing in the status quo. However, a drastic change or forcefully requiring these people to assimilate into those groups will only increase the anti-sentiments within those interior boundaries, Mr. Speaker. So what happens is, if you force acceptance or assimilation, is that rather than assimilating them, you outwardly now segregate those people and furthermore stigmatize those groups, Mr. Speaker. The very fact that you forcefully remove such rights from these individuals will only raise anger from these individuals. We believe that only aggravates such fraction within those groups areas, and it would only even more retract such movements that we've achieved at this point. For example, like gay priests and so on. Now we do not want to sacrifice the benefits that we've achieved at a certain point. We believe the government side is only doing worsening, only